Hello everyone. Welcome back to the University of the Witwatersrand's Fossil Hominid Vault here in Johannesburg, South Africa. I'm Lee Berger, a paleoanthropologist here at the university and explorer at large for the National Geographic Society. And today, we're going to talk about dating. Not dating in the human world, not dating in the social world. We're going to talk about dating fossil hominids by paleoanthropologists. You see, I think dating is much overused, at least for certain types of questions, particularly types of questions that deal with relationships. Relationships between different hominid species. Because dating has begun to replace the study of comparative anatomy and morphology with the idea of we understand where a hominid fits into the evolution of humankind just by how old it is. I believe that paleoanthropology got carried away with dates over morphology largely in the 1980s and 1990s as radiometric dating became more reliable. At the same time, it appeared that the hominid fossil record would remain sparse. Terms related to time that were not so common before in this science became newspaper headlines that accompanied major and minor discoveries alike, mostly out of Eastern Africa and Ethiopia, because there they could be dated. Loaded terms such as the first, the oldest, the beginning of humankind became used for almost every discovery. I think this was a natural occurrence for a science that thought it would exist forever with a record that consisted of fragments, many of which were picked up off the surface and thus had little or no context. It didn't help that the South African paleoanthropology was largely shut down due to apartheid, and in fact the cave deposits themselves seemed undateable at that time, a problem that might never be solved. So in such a situation where the likelihood of the fossil record of hominids never being good enough to test morphological relationships outside of perhaps dental comparisons, how old a fossil was became the most important criteria as to where it fit in the human origin story. Ideas that would not be found in other sciences began to emerge, such as only a single species of hominid existing at any one time in the past. Baggage, perhaps from an earlier era of science that saw humans as separate from the natural world and thus not following the evolutionary processes all other animals underwent, maybe because of our culture or something else. It was as if each fossil found represented a species that existed only in that moment. And as the next species emerged, the previous species would be wiped from the face of the earth. And so by as recently as the first decade of the 21st century, it became clear that hominid evolution was going to be anything but simple, thanks to evidence from the molecular record and a veritable explosion in hominid discoveries across the planet. Parts of the science of paleoanthropology still held on to old beliefs that the record it was observing and finding in the field was actually relatively complete and close to what was actually going on in the past. And therefore, the age of a fossil was what actually determined its position in the phylogeny of hominids. The hypothetical game I'd like to play with you is one I've had to play in the real world twice. And that is, once you've discovered a new species of hominid, how do you decide what other species it's related to? Which are its ancestors, which are its descendants, and which might just be sister species or parallel species. Let's imagine that you've discovered a new hominid species. For argument's sake, we're going to call this species Species X. And let's say you were fortunate enough to be able to date this species, and it dates to about 2 million years old. Now you want to find out what other species of hominids Species X might be related to. And in particular, you want to find out which species Species X might be descended from. Well, you're lucky enough because you have a primitive hominid species that's 3 million years old. Let's call this species Species L. So Species L is perfect. It's not only primitive to Species X,
but it's also a million years older. What could be a better ancestor? And so you hypothesize that species L gave rise to species X. Over the years, your hypothesis holds. You give talks at conferences how species L gives rise to species X. Other teams even find fossils, although fragmentary, that seem to support a transitional form between species L and species X. Even though this transitional form doesn't have a species name because it's based only on a mandible, let's call it species H. Because we knew that only one hominid species lived at any one time during this period of the late Pliocene, you became a paleoanthropological hero. You had proven that species L, through a transitional form like specimen H, had given rise to species X. Your hypothesis was proven. But then things began to get complex. Another team, in another location, found another new species. Let's call it species S. And it was the same age as species X. Well, actually, let's say it was younger. Let's say it was only 1.8 million years old. But it was primitive to species X. How could you have a species primitive to your species, yet younger? Well, at least you knew that since species S was younger than species X, that it didn't give rise to your species, even though it was more primitive in many ways, because evolution doesn't work like that. So, your hypothesis still stood. Species L must have given rise to species X, and species S must be just a side branch. But there were still some problems you recognized. How do you explain the presence of species S so late in time? After all, it was more primitive than species X. Well, at least you knew that species L must have given rise to species S. That was comforting. And species L, you knew from many, many years of study, had given rise to specimen H, which of course gave rise to species X. And so, once again, your hypothesis had stood the test of time and the fossil record. Species S was surely just a side branch. But then you began to think about it. Species S had clearly evolved from species L, and it was primitive. So what if it had evolved very early on, maybe just after 3 million years? If that were the case, that would mean that species S must have existed for hundreds of thousands of years before species X. It had at least emerged before specimen H, and that was 2.5 million years old. Unless all those primitive characters in species S were reversals, which seemed incredibly unlikely given how derived and evolved your species X was, the idea that species S had arisen much earlier in time based on its morphology gave you pause about your strong-held ideas about the relationship between specimen H and species X. After all, specimen H had been a surface find. Maybe the date was wrong, and it was only a tiny bit of mandible. Maybe there was the possibility that an earlier member of species S had actually given rise to species X. And once you began to recognize that species S must have had a long history prior to the group that had been discovered at 1.8 million years. It was, after all, a primitive species, both primitive to your species X and to the 2.5 million year old specimen H. And that would mean that at any time after that species had emerged, that it could have potentially given rise to your species X. And so you finally began to realize just how complex it was going to be to work out the phylogeny of early hominids in the late Pliocene if multiple species existed at the same time, some of them primitive and some of them derived. You would realize very quickly that not only could species S be the ancestor of your species X, it could also be the ancestor of specimen H, who in turn could also still be the ancestor of your species. And even those hypotheses, as complex as they were based on the idea that you had a good record of all the hominid species that lived in the late Pliocene. And you were pretty sure that we didn't.
So time is seen as so ubiquitously important in paleoanthropology today that sometimes I think it's misused. And it's misused particularly where we're dealing with phylogenies, that is, trying to understand the relationships between different hominid species, particularly ancestor-descendant relationships. That's where time seems to be, at least over the last several decades, used in place of morphology.
So let's put some real species into the hypothetical situation that I outlined earlier. Sidiba was species S in the hypothetical situation. Species X was something like Homo habilis, or one of the various early Homo that had been named around 2 million years. The 2.5 million year old specimen would be AL666 from Ethiopia, placed into the genus Homo, but not yet given a species name. And Afarensis is species L for Lucy at 3 million years. So in my hypothetical scenario, I've left out, obviously, many other species. And as we look forward and I explore this topic, I'm going to leave out, for the time being, the robust Australopithecines. But just to say that if I included them, and they do exist in this time range, then the story would be even more complex than I'm describing. But let's add in a few other candidates that are directly related to the question of who gave rise to the genus Homo. Leti Guerrero is a fossil that was discovered in Ethiopia that's been attributed to the earliest member of the genus Homo, but it's a mandible and a surface find. Then, of course, there's Africanus. Africanus, we believe, goes back to 2.8 to 3 million years in age and down to maybe as young as 2.1 million years. Of course, there's also the possibility, due to its primitive nature, that Sidiba goes back to a much earlier time period than the 1.977 million years of the population we have from Malapa. In some ways, there are parts of Sidiba's anatomy that indicate it's more primitive than Africanus, and so the possibility of it going back close to 3 million years is not out of the question. So if we accept even the remote possibility that Sidiba might extend back towards 3 million years in its origin, then it's possible it could give rise to something like Leti Guerrero. Leti Guerrero mandible is actually almost indistinguishable from that of Sidiba. And then Leti Guerrero could give rise to AL666 or something like it, which could give rise to some of these later Homo. There's also the possibility that Leti Guerrero may even be something like Sidiba or something wholly unrelated, a separate evolutionary event. Sidiba still, though, could give rise potentially to something like AL666 and the same evolutionary scenario occur if you want to place the origin of the genus in East Africa. But if you weren't vested in having the genus Homo have to have arisen in East Africa, and do remember that the evidence for it there is based only on two surface finds, a mandible and a maxilla, then Sidiba is anatomically a very good candidate for the ancestor of the genus Homo. And again, as I've pointed out, the time doesn't matter that much because surely the species existed both before and after. And that's really the critical point to take away. All of these species are existing prior to when we discover them, and are certainly existing after the time periods in which we discover them. That is simply the nature of the fossil record of ancient human relatives. Once you begin to realize that the nature of the fossil record means that the single discoveries or even multiple discoveries does not reflect the actual real biological range of that species in time, then absolute time becomes less important. We need to concentrate on the comparative anatomy. And once you do that, we begin to explore the complexities of relationships in the past. And these complexities can be vast. And that's without putting in hybridization, which we know can occur in at least the late Pleistocene, and therefore there's no reason to suspect such complex interactions didn't occur in the deep past as well.
One surprising artifact of the idea that there was only one species at any one time in the past was that when you found a fossil, no matter how fragmentary, you assigned it to a specific species that you thought lived at that time. You didn't look at the anatomy necessarily because you didn't have enough anatomy. Species that are a problem like this are Homo erectus, for example, where just about anything found within the time period of the Pleistocene was placed into Homo erectus. That is, until we found that there are many other species around at the same time. Now, we need to put those more fragmentary fossils aside and begin to look at more complete specimens to establish exactly what species were living at any time in the past and any particular geographical area. So what is understanding the age of these fossils and the species they represent good for? Well, it's good for understanding the environments and ecologies of the past, to look at how these particular hominid species interacted with other faunal communities, the animals that lived on the landscape at the same time, to look at possible competition between different species that might have occupied the same landscape, the same geographical region at the same time, and possibly learn about stresses and stressors that would affect future patterns of hominid evolution. What dates are also very good for is understanding when species are successful. When we start seeing the expansion of species into other regions, where we see a successful form that may occupy first a broad geographical region, then a continent, then perhaps even other continents. Dates are less useful for seeing extinction. Why? Because the fossil record is so very, very fickle. It's unlikely to show us all the species, all the variation that was existing at any one time in the past. Homo naledi is such a classic example of that. Here's a hominid that must have come out of deep time, was existing for perhaps millions of years alongside other species we recognized, and yet we didn't see it. And the same could be true of species like Sediba, Afarensis, Africanus, the robust Australopithecines, just about any form you can imagine.
Finally,
what I strongly don't think dates should be used for, now that we know that there are multiple species existing not only in Africa but across the world at many different time periods into the very deep past, is to identify what species you've discovered. Unless that fossil is good enough to give you a good anatomical comparison with important parts of the anatomy that can definitively say what species this is, I think you should just talk about the presence of hominids on the landscape and not bias your interpretation with the date and a presumption of species. So when trying to understand the relationship of any given hominid species, perhaps of lowest importance should be how old that species is. What you should look at first is its anatomy, its morphology. You should look at its primitive characters compared to other species. What derived characters does it have compared to other species? And what autapomorphic or uniquely derived characters does it have? In this way, you'll understand without the bias of time where your species might fit in the ancestor-descendant relationship of the whole of the hominid record. Well, I hope you've enjoyed this lecture from the Fossil Hominid Vault here at the University of the Witwatersrand on when dates are important, but more importantly, when they may not be so important. I'm Lee Berger. You can follow me on Twitter at Lee R. Berger, or like my public Facebook page, Prof. Lee R. Berger. Goodbye for now. Be safe out there. Keep washing those hands.